Glad you came to church today. Smoky, smoky, smoky out there last night, wasn't it? Let's pray that we'll have a supernatural rain happen on the state of Washington. Come on, let's just all agree right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we believe for rain. Who'd ever thought we'd be saying that in Washington? We believe for rain over the whole state of Washington. We call it wet in Jesus' name. Amen. For a short time. And everybody said amen to that. I've never prayed that prayer. I've never uttered those words out of my lips in the state of Washington before. Doing a series called How to Find Your Destiny, the Plans and the Purposes of God for Your Life. Kind of last week we talked about the power to do the will of God comes from the power to be with Him. In Mark chapter 3 and verse 14 and 15 says, then He appointed 12 that they might be with Him. I like that. They appointed 12 that they might be with Him. Then He might send them out to preach and to have power to heal sickness and to cast out demons. You see, we overlook sometimes that the power to do in our own strength will lead you into burnout. I remember a time when six, 7 years into ministry. I was 23 when we started, so I was probably under 30 when this happened. So I was an old guy. I was under 30. And we'd already been pastoring 6 or 7 years. And I got so busy doing the ministry that I forgot just to, my time of prayer, my time of worship, my time with Jesus just slipped because I was so busy doing the ministry. And one night we had this little house office space, and Mitch Fox was there and another lady, and we'd called a meeting of all of our small group leaders, and they kept canceling over and over. They kept canceling. I won't be there tonight, won't be there tonight, won't be there tonight. And I'm prepared, and I sat in my desk chair, and I started crying. I'm like 29 years old, and I start crying. And I'm thinking, I am flipping losing it. Flipping is the Greek for, no, never mind, you want to know that. But I was having like this, I think I was having a nervous breakdown. I mean, I think I was like, and so I just said, oh, wait a minute. I see, I'm smart enough. You know, I'm smart enough to know one of the things I've done in my life, I'm not the smartest, not sharpest knife in the drawer, but if I do hit myself with a hammer, I don't do that anymore. And so I hit my head with a hammer. I was starting to go through this process of where I just let, and so I packed up. I went to Florida for a week, and I stayed in the hotel room, and I just sought the Lord for just a few days, just sought the Lord. My buddy was down there, and I just sought the Lord and stayed in the hotel, just me and the Lord. And I said, you know, I will never allow my be with Him to ever take place of the do part again. And we've been going at it. You know, there's been some ups and downs, but never even come close to that edge again, because the power to do has to come from the power to be with Him. Amen? So last week we talked about that you have a placement and a purpose like Adam had in the garden. You have dominion. And then we ended up last week's message about, we talked about your creativity, that God has made each one of you creative. I wanted to give you a little thought today on some of the most creative people in the world do things interesting. So I have two videos that I want to play. The first video, you're going to say, what's this all about? And the second one will explain it. So let's run the first video. Talking about creativity now, remember this.
It's almost painless.
Thank you.
Okay, now that's the first video, and you say, what did he play that for? Let's look at the creative genius by one of the people that you all know and recognize. Let's add some music to that and find out where the creative genius of this man came from. Let's play the second video. Things I've never done. Prayed for rain in the state of Washington and played Billie Jean in church. Thank you. Pastor Jerry says thank you. A lot of times we think that, you know, you look at a guy like Michael Jackson, you say, oh, he's the most creative guy in the world and just amazing. He's the king of pop, and he stole it from this guy. His dance moves from this guy. And he actually did it. They give him credit for it, I mean, and everything. And so sometimes creativity may not be as hard as we think it is. It might be just adding on to something that somebody's already done. You're extremely creative. You just need to think like that, and creativity might take some hard work. Amen? God has a plan for everybody. Everybody, every single person in this room, God has a destiny and a plan set and laid out for you. It doesn't have to be. You don't have to do something what the world would consider great. You just need to obey God. I found that obeying God is really the key to our lives. Now, whatever that means to you, it's different. For me, it's to be the pastor of Faith Center. For you, it might do something else. It might be something else. But obeying God and being what God called you to be, it might be the best mom in the world, it might be the best dad in the world, it might be the best business owner in the world. It's what you can do with your potential to be the best that you can be. There's several scriptures along that line. Jeremiah 1:5 says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you and ordained you as a prophet to the nations. I know he's talking about Jeremiah, but I think we can go with that principle there. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. God knew who you were before the foundations of the world. Psalms 139, you were formed and you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. And I love Ephesians chapter 2. The Amplified Version in Ephesians chapter 2 says this. For we are God's own handiwork. This is Amplified. 2:10. For we are God's own handiwork. His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, born anew that we may do good works, which God predestined, planned beforehand for us, taking paths which he prepared ahead of time that we should walk in them, living the good life which he prearranged and made ready for us to live. God has a prearranged purpose for every single person here. Now, when you say prearranged or does God predestine us? In other words, you know, some people take predestination to an extreme. They say, well, God predestined me to be saved, so I'm saved, but, you know, everybody else just, you know, it's like God predestined us to do what we're doing. And this is why I look at it. Is God looks at your life, he looks at what's going to happen to you, the negatives, the positives, he looks at the abuse you're going to go through. He didn't order that, but the reality is man messes things up. He didn't order that. He didn't allow that. It just happened to you. He looks at your addiction, he looks at your negatives, he looks at your positives, he looks at, you know, your family structure, your family situation, and he says, with that in mind, I'm going to develop a plan and a purpose for them from the foundations of the world to walk in them, to walk in their ways. So I grew up with an alcoholic father, died at 63 years old, which is just a few years older than I am, died at 63 years old. and didn't have much of a relationship. We'd call each other, but didn't have much of a relationship. He was so drunk at the end of his life all the time that I'd call up and say, Dad, I want to take you to lunch today. And he'd say, that's right, let's do it next Tuesday. Then he'd call me up and say, I just can't make it today. Something came up. And I knew from that he couldn't get out of the house because he was so drunk he couldn't get out of the house. Well, God looked at that, you know, and for my whole high school years, I really didn't have a father. I was kind of fatherless through my whole high school years. And, you know, he tried his best and different things, but God looked at that and looked ahead and said, that's what's going to happen to Glenn. So now I try to be a father to many. That's just my thing, is I try to be a father to many. I try to be a pastor to pastor. I try to, you know, I'm not trying to go get into anybody's lives, but I try to be a father. It's just my heart is to become a father of a generation of young people. And hopefully we're, you know, I'm not trying to force that, or, you know, we don't have a small group or a teaching on that. It's just trying to live our lives and be a father to many people. And it's just my thing, because that's the predestined plan that God had for me, because he saw ahead, saw all my negatives, saw all the things I'd go through, saw that I was heading down my father's footsteps and different things. And we, you know, we stand up for certain things and we don't do certain things because of my upbringing in different situations. So God looks ahead and sees, oh man, that person was, oh gosh, it's a bummer, but they were abused by, you know, by that person, and with their personality and some of those things, I'm going to use that. I'm going to take them. I'm going to use that. We're going to use that to help a lot of people. We're going to use that. You know, it's a bummer that the world treated them that way, but we're going to use that. We're going to use that personality, their ups, their downs, everything. God has a specific plan. He knows the very hair on your head are numbered. Some of you, it's about two. Some of you, three. Some of you, just whatever. All right. But God knows our intimacies. He knows all about us. He knows everything about us. And he can plan, has a destiny for you. Let me read that scripture again. You are God's own handiwork, recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that may do the good works which God predestined, planned beforehand for us, taking the paths which he prepared ahead of time. You should walk in them, living the good life which he prearranged and made ready for us to live. Seems like God allows some of this stuff, but I don't think he allows it. I think it's just we live in a cursed world and things happen to us, and he just moves that thing and works with us in everything that we do. Jeremiah 29:11, now God's purpose is always good. It's always a positive thing in our lives. He always wants to bring out something good in our lives. Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Sometimes we think that God's, you know, something happens to us, a situation, a negative situation, and we think that, well, somehow I gave up on the Lord because of this negative situation, when in reality, maybe it's just part of the plan. You know, well, I this person was in my life, and there was my boyfriend, and they broke up with me, and I thought it was God's will, and da-da-da-da-da. You know, what's that country western song, Thank God for Unanswered Prayer? You know, I thank God for unanswered prayer when I married my wife. Thank God I married my wife instead of some of the wonderful people that I thought I was will of God to marry. You know, and I mean, just thank God. I thank God every day that for unanswered prayer. Amen? Can you relate to that at all? I'm just setting a little thing here. So number one, God's nature is it's always good. Number two, we've got to choose the plan for our life. I think there's many people in here that just half-heartedly go after the things of God, and you would never know, you'll never know what you could have until you just really choose and say, you know what, I'm going to sell out to Jesus. I am going to sell out 100% and watch what he'll do in your life. You would be amazed. You say, well, I'd have to give up that, and I'd have to give up that, and I'd have to give up that. You'd be amazed at what God wants to do in your life if you just totally sell out to him. You have to choose. I like this scripture in Deuteronomy 30:19. I call heaven and earth as a witness together against you. I've set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. Yeah, I like that. It's like choosing for dummies. I'm giving you two choices. And by the way, in case you can't figure it out, choose life, that you and your descendants may live. And the third thing is on that, and then I'm going to get into some other stuff. You have to steward your gift. The gift that God gives you, you can develop that gift into something amazing, or you can just sit on it your whole life. I tell you, folks, I tell you, the purpose and plans and purposes of God, I want everything God has for me. I just have to pinch myself sometimes to think about some of the things I've been honored to do in my life. And there's just no way that of my own self I would ever even come close to accomplishing anything that I'm doing today. I'm just honored to be in the position I'm in. Get asked to speak in different churches and wrote a book and go to the Philippines and different things. And I'm honored to be in the position I'm in. But it's the only reason I'm here is because I don't know anything else except to sell out to Jesus. I've got no other thing to do but just to sell out and say, God, I'm a mess. Just help me. If you can do something with this life, then do it. Boy, I tell you, it's amazing what he'll do. I want to encourage you. If you haven't sold out, I mean sold out. I mean say, Lord, you want me to stop that? I'll do that. You want me to quit that? You want me to do this? You want me to add that? Whatever. I don't care what it is, Lord. I'll do it for you. You'll be amazed at the journey that you'll be on. It won't always be fun. It won't always be great. But the reality is you'll find your destiny. And when you do that, you'll look back and say, wow, what a great ride that was. Yeah, but I might have to give up this, and he's going to take away all my fun. And, oh, man, you don't even know what fun is. You've been lied to about your fun. I'm having more fun than a barrel of monkeys. Is that a, remember that statement? No, you don't remember that. Kind of back with that 1960s movie. All right. 7 billion people on the earth, not one person alike. Not one person looks alike. We're so rare when you say, you know, I ran into a guy that looked just like you today. The reason why we say that happens about once every 10 years. And the reason why we say it is because it's amazing when someone looks like us. 7 billion people, and God didn't make one person alike. We're all different. That means he has a plan and a purpose for everybody. That's amazing God, isn't it? Many times when I was with Jay and Annalisa in the Philippines, and I'll just walk along there, and there'll be some person, some poor person that's, you know, some just extremely poor person with long hair and just looks like, the demoniac in Gadarene or something like that. And I think to myself, God knows that person, has a plan for him. God has a plan and a purpose for every single person. God has a destiny and a plan for every single person in this room. God has a specific plan and purpose for you. I believe you're going to fulfill that. Let me give you a few things today that we can just look at. Some questions to ask, some things to pay attention to. Let me give you about 8 quick things. I won't take a lot of your time. Let me give you 8 quick things that you can look at in your life to just kind of find your destiny. Number one is, what's the desire of your heart? Psalm 37:4 says, delight yourself also in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. What's the true desire of your heart? What do you have deep down in your heart that you just can't get away with, you can't get away from year after year after year? Many people will say, you know, I'm working for somebody else. I really want to start this business. You have a desire to start that business, but you just don't do it because you don't step out. You really don't step out into what God has for you. Maybe it's time to not quit your job, but to go ahead and start that business. You know, Willie George brings out something that's phenomenal. He calls it, the sixth day. And it's a phenomenal teaching that, you know, the Lord said, he said, you'll work 6 days, and on the seventh day you rest. In America, we work 5 days, and then we rest Saturdays and Sundays. But the Lord said you're going to work 6 days, and on the seventh day you rest. So I wonder if maybe Saturday, or whatever day you have off besides Sunday that you should be in church in, I wonder if that day might be a day to start that second thing that you've been a desire of your heart to do. Maybe something that God's placed on your heart to do. Maybe do something on that day. You say, well, I'm already busy enough. I know you're already busy enough, but maybe that's part of fulfilling your destiny, is find that extra day and spend a couple hours doing that. You know, my destiny is to pastor the church. I really don't know why I exist except to pastor the church, be married to my wife. But I don't know why I exist beyond that, but I like to mess around with real estate a little bit. I kind of enjoy it. I just kind of enjoy that. So I take a few hours. It doesn't take me long, but I take a few hours of something. I don't let it consume me. It doesn't take away from the ministry here. But I take a few hours, and I study real estate, invest in it, build stuff. I like that. It's kind of fun. Keeps me in Harley money. But it's just something I do on the side. So what's the true desire of your heart? God will place those desires in your heart. And once he places them there, when he placed the desire to pastor in my heart, I thought he's crazy. I thought, man, you know, you're crazy, Lord. You're picking the wrong person. But you have to go with the desire of your heart. Number two, know what stirs your passion. John 2:17, Jesus was a man of passion. It says, disciples remembered it was written, zeal for my house. It was eating him up. Remember when he went in there? And Jesus goes in there and he gets that and he starts whipping people and turning over tables. And he said, my house should be called a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. And the dude had some zeal. And then he was on his way to Jerusalem and he had his face like flint to Jerusalem. He says, and then he talks about this zeal. He said he just had a zeal for it. What stirs your passion? Almost every day, my life consists of, I enjoy my day, but my night times are very tough. Be honest with you, I discovered melatonin, or I don't even think, I mean, sleep has just been like something for me that's just a bother, you know? But I go to sleep about 9 or 10 or 7 or 8 or 6 or whatever time I go to sleep. And when I go to sleep, I crash. I crash hard. I try to make it till 9 o'clock, and I make it till, and then it from, and I go from 9 to about 12. And then I wake up, and I'm wide awake. And then I fight to get sleep the rest of the night. But what I'm fighting is the passion I have for you. The thought process of how to win people, how to change lives, where's the church going? What can we do? And it just consumes me. It's like, I need some drugs or something, you know? Because you guys consume my heart. That's all I think about. I think, Lord, when am I going to rest? I mean, but it just consumes me. Sleep is hard for me because the zeal of God just consumes me so much that I have to figure out ways to turn this thing off. Get it off, man. Turn it off, Lord. I don't want this thing anymore. Let me just not think about this stuff. And I think about it so much on, you know, Fight Club. We're going to get these men going. And the guys had an amazing barbecue the other night. Bonfire the other night. It was an amazing time of guys worshiping together and doing all kinds of crazy stuff together. It was fun, man. But where does that come from? It comes from the middle of the night. What are we going to do? I got to think about this. What are we going to do? Is there something that consumes you? Is there something that drives you? Well, no, Pastor, there's not. Well, I bet there is. You just need to meditate on it a little bit and think about it a little bit. What consumes you? What drives you? You know, you say, well, all I want to be, I just want to be a mom and have kids and raise those kids. That's the zeal of the Lord. That's the leading of the Lord, man. Go for that thing. Don't feel condemned like you got to fit in somebody else's box. God will not judge you and say, you know, you are a great imitation of so-and-so. He's going to judge you for what you did, not what everybody else did. Here's another one. What flows from you naturally? Romans chapter 12, verse 4 says, for as many as members of one body, the members do not have the same function. So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace of God that is given us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy to the proportion of our faith. What flows from you naturally? You know what's amazing to me? Is the talent that we have around here for artistic ability. I mean, especially like, I mean, drawing and stuff like that. I think about different people, Morgan and Mitch and different people, and Mitch will make you these cards, and he fills out these cards, and he makes them, and they're just these handmade, beautiful cards, and I think, God, man, I'm having trouble with stick figures. and our worship team's amazing. You know, Matt Golke gets up here, and he's excellent on 42 instruments, you know. It's just not fair. I mean, I'm looking at a guitar thinking, I wish I could play that thing, you know. And then Therese and I go around the house singing, we're worshiping, and it's a mess. It's a mess around our house. Don't you dare record it, man. It's terrible. Therese is a terrible singer, and I'm worse. I mean, she's terrible. But I'm worse. We can't sing. I mean, it's like, well, I need to take voice lessons. No, I don't. I just make a joyful noise to the Lord. Are you getting what I'm saying here? you know, your thing might not be, I love real estate. I don't know. My dad was into it. I love it. It feels like I'm elk hunting. When I kill a piece of real estate, I like killing it. I want to mount it on the wall. I just love it, man. I love getting in there and just, I love killing real estate, you know. I didn't care about the money. I just like killing, you know. I'm killing real estate, that is. But what's your passion? What flows from you naturally? What kind of flows from you? Maybe you ought to develop something around that. Do you think the Lord's going to, you know, give you a great singing voice, an ability to play an instrument, and say, and what I want you to do with that is absolutely nothing. I just want you to, I'm giving you this ability to play the piano, and my goal for you is to sit on that and never use it for God's glory. Just sit in there, don't play the drums, don't play the guitar, because I'm too busy. Well, you answer the Lord about that, not me. Because what flows from you naturally? I'm a leader. I'm a teacher. You know, it's like I tell people sometimes, I do two things well. I can't remember what the second one is. But I'm a leader. I can teach the word. I'm a decent leader. I like to be, you know, two or three things. And I just flow with those. And I just learn not try to change my strengths or my weaknesses. You know, I Dave White in my life to help me with finances. I'd be a mess without Dave. Dave comes up, man, he's got this, and, you know, we're going to save 32 cents on that and 40 cents. And I was like, what do I care? You know, I mean, I don't care about that stuff. I mean, other than I want to know where we're at, I don't care about that stuff. It's amazing how Dave just got this gift to just help our church with finances and things, and he's helped many of you in different things. And it's been amazing to me. I surround myself with people that kind of prop my weaknesses up because I'm just, why would I spend 1 minute of my time learning to budget? Why would I spend one? I know, I understand things. I understand how to do it because I have to, because I need to read sheets and things like that. But the reality is, why would I go to school to do that? I hate that stuff. Maintenance is the devil in my opinion. I hate maintenance. I mean, I'm good at building, but I'm bad at maintenance. I'm just bad at it. I don't do things well because it doesn't flow from me naturally. Number four. Are you getting any of this? Just things you can find the will of God. Seek counsel from mature Christians. Where there's no counsel, the people fail. But the multitude of counselors, their safety. Fascinates me the way you get somebody that loves people and you get you get somebody who loves you and you'll ask them counsel. And you'll sit there and you'll tell them, you know, here's what you need to do, da 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 da. And you surround yourself with five different people that tell you the same counsel, and then you do the opposite of that. It's like, what are you thinking? In the multitude of counselors, there's safety, and I see it all the time. Well, I love him. Oh, I hate that. Don't marry that guy, man. He's a mess. He doesn't even have a job. I know, but he will someday. Oh, man, you show me the money, I'll show you the honey. That needs to be the model right there. My Theresa and I don't know if you know this or not, but we were dating. We were dating, and I was just being stupid. And I said, look, I don't think you're the right one for me, and sent her on her way, you know. And my alcoholic dad came to me, and he said, what the hell are you doing? Forgive me for saying that, but that's what he said. I'm quoting now. That's not me speaking. I'm quoting, but... And he's like, what the blank are you? I don't even know if he said that. Probably used the F. What the? Yeah, that's the best thing that ever happened to you. Even my alcoholic dad had more wisdom than I did at that time. Did I really say hell in church in that context? This is going down in the annals of history, and I, you know, this is not good. You can't get away with anything anymore you just because it's all on video and stuff. So. Good word. All right, we'll go with that. Listen to the witness of the Holy Spirit. Jordan quoted this morning. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, whereby you cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God. Next few weeks, we're going to talk to you about how to be led by the Spirit. We're going to talk about how Paul was led by the Spirit. We're going to give you... There's a guy that started off, and he started listening to... teachings on how to be led by the Spirit. He started off with $50, and he turned that $50 into $50 million. And he did it by just listening to his spirit. What is the spirit saying? We're going to start teaching that. Next week we're going to talk about how to be led by the spirit. Is the witness of the spirit bear witness with? Number six, what can you give your life to? 1 John 3:16, by this we know, because he laid down his life for us, we ought also to lay down our lives for the brethren. What can you give your whole life to? Now, let me say this. Not what makes you mad and you want somebody else to do. If I've heard this once, I've heard it 100 times. Pastor, what we'd like to see at Faith Center is this ministry. And we say, that's great. When are you going to start it? And they always say, no, we want you to do it. And I can't tell you in the beginning stages, and some of you pastors can relate, but we started so many ministries because somebody wanted us to start it. And the only person that has to be committed to it is me, not them, because they just wanted you to start it. It's amazing to me the way that happens. So what are you willing to give your life to? What are you willing to sell out, pack up, move across the country, whatever it takes? I'm going to give my life to this, and I don't care what it costs me. Because the will of God will cost you something. It'll cost you friends. It'll cost you acquaintances. It'll cost you something, but it will pay rich dividends. What are you willing to pay? Number seven, this is a good one. What produces fruit in you? Why keep doing something that's fruitless? I've used this example many times, but if you're riding along on a horse and the horse dies, dismount. Get up and go, you rotten thing. Come on, baby. I'm going to get on my horse and ride. No, the sucker died 3 years ago. Dismount. Jesus said, if it doesn't bear fruit, cut it off. So people said, well, the Lord hasn't released me. Uh-huh, he did. The horse died. Released you already. If it doesn't bear fruit, there's a lot of things the Lord just said, I ain't even going to give him an answer on that. All they got to do is look in my word and see that for the last 3 years, there is absolutely no fruit in that thing. There's no fruit. Dismount. That's the deepest thing you'll... I know that's going out on Twitter and Facebook and everything else. If you're riding a horse and it dies, dismount. If there's not producing fruit, Matthew 12:33 says, either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree bad, its fruit bad, for a tree is known by its fruit. The other thing with that is, too, is you can call yourself a pear tree. I'm a pear tree, I'm a pear tree. You can sing it, I'm a pear tree, da 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 da, I'm a pear tree. But when apples start growing, baby, you're an apple tree. So you can call yourself whatever you want. But when your fruit comes out, that's the real crux of the matter. So in your life, what's not bearing fruit? We've had to analyze our services many times. We were doing an hour and a half, hour and 45 minute services. Now we're about an hour and 15 minutes. And we started looking at what we were doing and say, well, why do we do that? I don't know. Let's cut that out. Why do we do that? I don't know. Let's cut that out. How long are we doing that? That's way too long. Let's cut that out. We still have the word and ministry time and didn't cut any time out of the service because it wasn't bearing fruit. What's not bearing fruit in your life? Now, if it's your husband, that's not what I'm talking about there. But what's not bearing fruit? I started this business, and it's just not bearing fruit. Well, then go back to do something else. It's not bearing fruit. Give it a ride for a while, but if the horse dies, dismount. Amen? Last one, and we're done. Let peace be your umpire. I believe this is amplified, I think. It says, Colossians 3:15 says, let the peace, the soul harmony which comes from Christ, rule, act as an umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds in the peaceful state to which as members of Christ, one body, you are also called to live. Be thankful, appreciative, giving praise to God always. What's the peace of God? Now, a lot of times the peace of God, what we think peace Peace means the, we think that peace means the absence of trouble or smoothness. No, it's just the opposite of that. It's that inner, I know that I know when all hell's breaking loose. That's the peace that you're ruled by. That's the peace that we, okay, this says that we're not supposed to do this. This says we're not supposed to, but I got this peace. It's just, I'm following the peace of God that surpasses understanding here. I'm just going to let that peace rule as an umpire in my life. So there's just some practical things. Next week, like I said, we're going to get into next week. We're going to specifically talk about how you can be led by the Spirit. God has a destiny and plan, but we need to be led by the Spirit. Many times in my life, that in your life, this has happened to you. How many of you have ever done something and you knew that when you did something, you know, said, man, I know I wasn't supposed to do that. I had something on that and I violated that. Anybody ever done that before? The rest of you are liars. But just this week. This happened to us. When did it happen to us, man? This guy at the house. Wednesday. I think it was Wednesday, whatever it was. For some reason, I said, I need a security system for my house. I need a security system, and they had a real cool one where I could actually get on my phone. I could get on my phone, I can look at what happens at my house, you know. So we just installed the security system, and we never had one. 12 years at our house, never had one. But I said, I just have to get a security system. I just knew that I had to get one. This week, Wednesday, at Jay and Jason were over, and they left at 9:38 because I watched them go out on my phone. At 9:54, I told Jay to shut my or lock my door because you can just it's like a you can push, you can just touch the lock now and it locks. And normally we don't lock our house up, you know, until after we go to bed, things like that. Well, right after Jay leaves, 10 minutes later, 9:54, somebody's trying to get into my house through the front door. I mean, they're trying to get into my house. So this is like, Teresa said, I think I hear something. So I get on my phone, I'm looking, I said, there's a guy running around outside my house. And I won't tell you everything that happened, but cops came, arrested him, stuff like that, but I wonder what would have happened were you led by the Spirit? I don't know, but it's just like, I know I just needed to give the security. If it wasn't for that just one reason, because the guy was actually trying to get in my front door, if that door wasn't locked, we got a mess on our hands. We got a mess on our hands. And can I say this humbly? He's got a mess on his hands. I mean, I don't mean, you know, you understand. He's got a mess on his hands. And I'll just leave it at that. But, so I bought the security system for his purposes, not mine. You laugh about it, but I'm just, you know, my family is my family. You know, it is what it is. But my point is just simply this. I wonder how many times we've had stuff like that happen to us, and we didn't do it. What I'm going to teach you over the next few weeks is how to be sensitive to that voice and how to say, ooh, you know, remember what Pastor said here? Maybe the Holy Spirit's trying to tell me something here. I'm going to talk to you how to develop your spirit to a place where you can hear the voice of God, and maybe we can avoid stock market crashes and different things. I had the Lord. Well, there's a couple things, investments that I didn't invest in, and I knew I should have, but it's like I didn't pay attention because my fear overrode my voice, the voice. The fear overrode the voice, or not the voice, but the will of God isn't always a voice. Sometimes it's just a perception of something I need to do. And my fear overrode the perception that I had, and I missed out on some pretty cool deals that I believe the Lord had for me. So over the next few weeks, we're going to get into it in depth. We're going to show you, biblically speaking, how to be led by the Spirit. Anybody interested in that? All right, come back next week and we'll get you going here. I want to just, as my elders come and leaders come and be ready for our prayer time, and don't forget our elders meeting tonight too, guys. But as our elders come, I just want to give a couple invitations to you. If you're here today and you've never made Jesus the Lord of your life, God has such a plan and a purpose for you. I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thoughts of peace, he has an absolute plan and a purpose way bigger than you have, and way more fun, way more fulfilling than you could ever live on your own. And I don't mean this by like, oh, it's 10% better. I mean, it's 2,342 times better than what you could live on your own. But you got to make Jesus Lord. How do you make him Lord? You just say, Father, be my personal Savior. I want to accept you as my Savior. And then you're changed from the inside out. And God just makes you a son of God immediately. Not about what you've done or cut this off or grow that out or join this church or anything like that. It's just, I'm going to give my life to Jesus and you'll watch what he'll do in your life. These people want to pray for you if that's you. Maybe you have prayer for healing. Maybe you need something in your life for people to pray for you. Then these people will be up here after we dismiss. Stand up with me if you would real quick. These people will be up here for any of those. Sometimes people text prayer requests in, and here's somebody fighting prostate cancer. Here's someone with a son that's going through addiction. Of course, you can see Pastor Bill and Vicky, raise your hand up right there. They are the addiction specialists in our church. They will get you set free in Jesus' name. And here's a person in needs direction. We call rain in the state of Washington in Jesus' name. Rain in the state of Washington. All over this state, we call rain in. You agreeing with that? Don't go home, watch the news and say, I wonder when it's going to rain. Say, it's raining in Jesus' name. We call rain in the state of Washington. Lord, I thank you for direction. Curse this cancer in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, that son will receive the wisdom of God, what they need. Give them the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, Lord, that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened. They'd know the hope of your calling, the riches of the glory of the inheritance in the saints, the exceeding greatness of your power towards us who are to believe. In Jesus' name we pray. And let's try to keep this front clear so people can come up and pray. God bless you guys. Next week, how to be led by the Spirit. Love you guys. Have a great week.